My work has mostly been in development and communications. I think I'm the older person in the group, and I actually started using internet in the late 80s. So I feel that I've had actually very intimate relationship with the topic we are discussing, and my work has been mostly in how to get development stories into mainstream media in such a way that that we're not only giving the bad news in media, because I started my work in development in Madhya Pradesh in 1969, and I realized that witnessing the tremendous amount of good grassroots work that was going on, it was never reported in the press, and so that became my mission in life, is to learn about development and then to communicate it to people who receive media. So I have worked, I've studied and worked in the US and Italy. I was in an international news agency's headquartered in Italy, where we got women journalists to write from a gender perspective. And we had 122, we had journalists from 122 countries writing about these issues in English, Spanish, Hindi, Urdu, French. So, towards the end of my work, from 1990 to the year 2000, I managed a women's feature service, which was headquartered in India, a global agency. And we were really the first women's agency to use internet to get stories from different parts of the world, to translate it, to edit it, and give it to mainstream media. So my relationship with this topic is quite old. One of the things I've realized is that most of us are actually networked almost 24 hours a day. Those of us who have the privilege to have a phone, to have a computer, to have access to internet, which this was not true 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. So we're living in an age which is rather revolutionary. And in some ways it's very exciting, and in some ways it's quite frightening. And I think I came in a little early in the last session, and I think many of the participants actually talked about that. So that's a good start. And in this network society, which we're discussing, there are ethical, policy, and legal challenges, which many of you have already raised in the session before. And since we are talking about rights and women's rights, there's bound to be a conflict in this, because we are not the only people who inhabit the world. You know, there are men, there are transgenders, there are rich, there are poor, there are disabled, there are minorities. So, you know, we live in a very, very complex world. And I think when we address this issue, it must be in the context of that. That we are not the only sex that walks on this earth, even if we wanted to. And this conflict, actually, in terms of a diverse population, also transfers over to the kinds of people that are using this technology. How I use the technology is very different to how Soumya uses it, or Rohini uses it, or Dhruv uses it, or any of you in this room use it. You know, just like none of us, you know, in the world, look like each other. I'm always amazed how in this huge world, do you ever wonder how each person looks different? And I'm pretty sure in the same way, none of us uses this technology in the same way. So you see what we are dealing with. We're dealing with a huge range of interests and needs and rights. And, you know, when we talk about inequality, in the last session people mentioned this, you know, we want to reach the last woman, we want to reach the poorest of the poor. Because in a country like India, it's not possible to talk about anything without the poorest of the poor, because we are such a divided society. And we're getting richer by the day, and sometimes we're getting a little poorer by the day. So it's impossible to talk about this topic without inequities. And the inequities that are in Indian society are bound to spill over into the topic that we're discussing today. There is no way that you can have complete democracy, complete equity in this network, the digital network. Because the digital network, no matter how much we like to think is different, is actually a mirror of society. And the technology is new, but guess what? We are the same old people, right? And it's hard for us to change. And that's why, much as we want to blame the technology, you know, the technology begins to mirror us. And I think this is what we also need to think about. And of course, you know, the interesting thing is that women's rights, the movement of women's rights globally and in India, came much before the digital age. Huh? So we have a huge history of women's rights struggles in this country, which continue today. But the digital age is brand new. And I consider that an advantage. You know, when people like Dhruv, when Dhruv talks about his work, I think Dhruv and many other people who do this kind of work have done a tremendous thing in taking the struggles that are going on and using the technology to leverage it and move it forward. And what the technology has done is helped us to connect these rights movements to succeed. And because of this, because of being able to connect and share, we've been able to strategize as to how we can advance women's rights. And of course, my favorite subject is when we talk of rights, we must talk about responsibilities. And this is where the planning for the future comes in. When you're talking about policy, when you're talking about legislation, when you're talking about regulation, that what is our role in having responsible policies, right? And our responsibility is to be as constructive as possible in this, I believe, you know, to the challenges and threats of the age that we're discussing. And there's also a conflict in the rights debate. You know, that, as I said earlier, we're talking about women's rights, but there are minority rights, there are indigenous rights, there are rights of this and that. So we're also talking about rights in a sphere which is a contested territory. It's not just a simple territory that you go and lay your claim. And we need to strategize around this if we want to succeed, because you're a player. We're all players in a stage, and that stage is very, very full already. But one of the good things, it seems to me, about the age we're living in, the network digital age, is I see there's been a flattening of hierarchies. You know, that in India, we're a very feudal society. We are caste-ridden, we are class-ridden, you know, we are divided by sex, we're divided by gender, we're divided by color, et cetera, religion, of course. But my observation is that, especially the mobile phone, because people in the lower income groups actually do not have access as much as to the internet or computers as we more privileged people do. But the mobile phone is an excellent example of how women's lives have been revolutionized, and you hear anecdote after anecdote from all parts of the countries. And I think when we discuss privacy, that seems to me that what the mobile phone has offered to women, and often poor people, is some privacy. Because the poor actually have no privacy. We just assume they'll bathe in the open, they'll eat in the open, they'll sleep in the open, you know, they'll have sex in the open, and that's okay. Why do they need any privacy? But what the mobile phone has done, and especially for women, for the first time, you know, they can move away and have a conversation without everybody in the kitchen sink knowing what is being said and who is calling her, most importantly. There's an interesting example in the mobile phone industry that many women have been have started using this dual SIM phones. Many of you are aware of that. And I often wondered, what is the advantage of dual SIM? But my husband, who works in the telecom industry, told me the other day that apparently women are using this more and more. They are the largest buyers of dual SIM phones, because they use one SIM to make outgoing calls, okay? And that number does not register, okay? If I'm calling the local store, if I want some chai patti and chips or sugar or what, I can order it on the phone, but he can't call me back and ask, kitna bhejo? Main bhool gaya, aur kuch bhejna hai aapko? He can't do that, because that number will not be registered with him. And then I have another number in which I receive incoming calls. So in many ways, women have learned to protect themselves, as we've all learned how to protect ourselves in our territory. So the example I'm giving is that women have been able to actually use this technology to empower themselves, right? And finally, we talk about legislation, which we will be discussing here, and regulation and policy. And as Anita said in the last session, when all of you made your presentations, that there is the beginnings of legislation and regulation and policy, but it's clearly insufficient. And therefore, there is a huge role in forums like this, at groups like ICT for Change, to actually jump in and enable some policy making that will enable the issues to be addressed that we are discussing. And finally, I want to talk about governance, because that's an issue which will be addressed here also, that I was also part of some e-governance programs which were started 10, 15 years ago, and we started very enthusiastically because, you know, every technology that comes, you know, we feel that this will take care of all our problems, right? But actually the truth of it is that if you don't have governance in a country like India, how are you going to have e-governance? You can have the best technology. Seriously. You can have the best technology to ensure that corruption will be eliminated, that manipulation will be eliminated. But you know what? We Indians are so ingenious. We will find a way around it. Yes. Hannah, you can speak to this. She will speak to this. We will find a way around it. So, how do we deal with this?